from the highest of heights.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea. Creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring.
Indescribable. There's nothing compared to you. And Lord, what a wonderful truth. Lord, it's surreal when we wake up to headlines like we've had this week. We wonder if we're going to get into it with another power, Lord. And Father, we just are so grateful that this is all under your control. You are sovereign, and nothing happens that you have not allowed, and it's all moving to your return. And before that, we go to be with you. How far we have, how long that is, we don't know, but it seems like it's really close, Lord. So we just thank you, Lord, that we are in Christ. And our citizenship is in heaven with you. And we are secure in that. Because we know one day, Lord, in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, we'll be with you and our loved ones. And we will ever be with you again, never to leave. Thank you, Lord. Thank you that no matter what we see going on around us, we don't have to fret. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King.
No more crying.
No more crying, dear. We are going to see the King. No more crying.
Soon and very soon, Lord, it sure seems like we're going to see you.
How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty, for my soul lost and even faints for you. For here my heart is satisfied.
One day.
One thing I ask, and I would seek, to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells.
One thing I ask.
And I would seek
flesh cry out.
My heart in flesh cry out to you, the living God. Your Spirit's water for my soul. I've tasted and I've seen. Come once again to me. I will draw near to you. I will draw near to you.
Better is one day.
Better is one day. Better is one day. Better is one day. Thousands elsewhere. Better is one day. Better is one day. Better is one day. Thousands elsewhere.
Better is one day in your courts.
Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day.
Day forward to the day you come and take us to be with you. No matter how that happens, Lord, we just pray that we would live surrendered lives. Lives that are committed to your word. That we don't feel our way through this life. And we certainly don't buffet and do it the way we want to do it. No, Lord, we want to live surrendered. surrendered lives. We want to be in the center of your will, led by your Holy Spirit, and know the joy of being right where you want us to be at any given moment. Lord, the joy of you working in and through our lives. I know I speak for myself, but I think we all want to see you answer our prayers. We like to see you do wonderful things when we pray about it. We pray for people, for needs. Well, you've told us that the secret to answered prayer is that we abide in you and your words abide in us. It's an abiding relationship, a surrendered life. And it's something, Lord, that every time we wake up in the morning, we're challenged with it. We can be challenged with it throughout the day. So, Lord, but you know that our frames are but dust, and you help us, Lord, but help us to even desire it. Desire to have you in control. So, Lord, that's our heart, Lord, and that's our desire to have you ruling and reigning and us surrendered. Thank you, Lord. Let's all stand.
My comfort.
Shout to the Lord.
Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy.
It's true every night. It's true every morning. It's true through the day. It's true through the midnight watches, Lord. And Lord, as we look around and we see the things going on in this world, man, I'm getting excited. You know, just at any moment, Psalms 83 could get set off. And man, it looked like it might have, and it still could before the week is over. And Lord, we know the chain of events that take place, Lord. And we know somewhere in that we go home. And so, Lord, we just thank you that we're living in some very exciting times. And Lord, help us to be like the five wise virgins, making sure that our lamps are burning bright and clean and we have plenty of oil, that we take the advice that Jesus gave, watch, be ready, you know not the day or the hour the Lord comes. And so, Lord, we're watching, we're waiting, and we're doing so with bated breath tonight. Lord, we're on the very precipice of seeing prophecy fulfilled again in a very Old Testament kind of way. And so, Lord, we just thank you for that. Lord, I want to pray for those in our fellowship that are sick. I want to pray for little Nathan, Lord, as he burned his hand. You know, Lord, just pray that you would heal that. There wouldn't have to be any skin grafts or any ramifications from it. You would just take care of it, Lord. You love your little kids, Lord, and you know, as much as Nick and Ginger love him, Lord, how much more do you? And so we pray for the hand, and we pray they would heal quickly. We pray for his grandma, for her knee, Lord. You know, we have two cripples walking in here tonight. Lord, we thank you for the operation, that it was a success. It looked like Nathan wanted to play with a cane that his grandma, Lori, needed. But, Lord, we just pray for healing in that. Lord, we pray for Gary tonight. We thank you that the back surgery was a success, Lord, and he was here yesterday without any pain. We pray for his heart now. He's going to be the $6 million man when they're done. Lord, we just pray that, Lord, whatever it needs to take place, you would fix Gary. And just, you know, he doesn't get to leave a day earlier than the rest of us. I told him that yesterday. And so, Lord, we just pray for his healing. We pray for Terry Shavola, that she would get her surgery, Lord, she needs. And pray for Sherry Marinovich, Lord, that the cancer would just stay away, Father, that as she goes through the radiation treatment, Lord, it would just kill whatever cells were left over after the surgery, Lord, and that you would just bring her to complete health. And for those that are home with the head colds, that stuff's going around. It almost got me, but, Lord, you blessed me, and it did catch up to me, and we thank you for that. But for the ones that it has, Lord, just be with them, Lord, we pray tonight in the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's kids would say, amen. Amen. Well, greet one another for a few moments before you find your place. Hey, let's turn our Bibles again to Proverbs. We come as far as chapter 9 this evening, and that's where we're going to pick up. So if you'll turn to Proverbs chapter 9, put your finger there on verse 1. We're going to get through all 18 verses tonight. And as you're putting your finger there, let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. And now as we come to the end of the first section, first nine chapters, as it were, is Solomon speaking to his son Rehoboam, as a father would to one of his children, Lord, trying to impart into this young man wisdom. And, Lord, he just kind of puts in a he puts a capstone on it tonight. He kind of just summarizes it in a very powerful and pithy way. And so, Lord, help us to have ears to hear tonight what it is that's being said, as wisdom is being personified and put up against the temptations that we will experience as Christians in this world, those things that try to draw us away. And then he will again remind his son of consequences for being obedient and consequences for being disobedient. So, Lord, just again, give us ears to hear. And Lord, the things that you teach us tonight from your word, Lord, by the Holy Spirit, give permanency to those things we would pray. In the mighty name of Jesus, we would ask. And all God's kids would say, amen, amen. Hey, let me ask you a question before we get into our study tonight. How many would be interested on Sunday morning of us to do our prophecy update for 2019 review? Kind of, it's going right along with where we're at. In fact, there's a couple pastors right now that are taking the prophecy course because I met with several of them this week, and some of the things were going on I was talking about, they really weren't as up to speed on. And I said, well, we have a 6-part prophecy update that we did in 2019, just 3 or 4 months ago, and we walk all the way through the broad brush of Daniel's visions, Daniel 2, Daniel 7, Daniel 9, then we move into Psalms 83, where we're at currently today, and then what the future will look like as far as the Antichrist and the rapture. So maybe we can just do like a 1-hour overview. By no stretch of the imagination would be a complete thing, but maybe focus us again as the body of Christ on the times we're living in. Would that be something you guys, you Wednesday night people get to set the tone. Yes. So yes. The Sunday morning people don't get a vote. So I think we'll do it. Hey, we come to the end of the first section of the book of Proverbs. The first 9 verses of Proverbs, as it were, is Solomon, who's the author of this book, writing to his son, Rehoboam, who he's trying to impart wisdom to. And as it were, the application for you and I tonight is our Heavenly Father trying to speak to us, his sons and daughters, the things of wisdom. And as we come to chapter 9, that continuation of wisdom being personified continues on into chapter 9 as we come to it. And actually, it's encapsulated in probably the most pithy points that Solomon could bring to the fore on what wisdom looks like. And it's interesting because as we move through this, you're going to see Jesus in the center of this. It's so interesting to me that our Bible was written over about a 1,500-year period of time on 3 continents and by 40 authors. And listen, when you read it, it reads like one book. You know, you look at Psalms 22 and you see there that is a prophetic psalm that describes the crucifixion of Christ in detail. You go to Isaiah chapter 53 and there you see again, Jesus just comes to the fore. In fact, when Paul went about preaching the gospel and preaching that Jesus was the Messiah, the Christ, what book did he use? He used the Old Testament. The New Testament had not yet been written. And watch as Jesus comes to the fore in the first few verses as we look at Solomon now, trying to, at this last and late day, put this wisdom into his son. Listen to what he says about wisdom. Wisdom hath builded her house. You know, and again, as we look at the word for wisdom, we want you to understand what he's talking about. He's talking about truth. He's talking about biblical truth, spiritual truth, God's truth, not the truth of this world, not the human perception of truth, but the truth that God has clearly laid out in these 66 books that are entirely inspired of God. I love that Peter brings that to the fore in his epistle that, listen, all scripture, all writing, not the writers necessarily, but all written word, all graphy is God-breathed. It is inspired of God, and it is profitable for correction, for reproof, for instruction, that the man of God, the woman of God, the people of God may be thoroughly furnished unto all good works. When you begin to apply the truth of God's word to your life, and again, as I tell the men on Monday nights, the benefit is never just in the instruction. The benefit is in the application. When you begin to apply God's word to your life, it begins to produce something in you. It begins to build something in you. Wisdom, it constructs something in our life. And here Solomon said, wisdom hath builded her house. There's a dwelling place of safety and protection that wisdom builds. You know, it's interesting, we come to the gospel, and Jesus in Matthew chapter 7 talks about a man who built his house on a rock and a man who built his house on the sand. And it's interesting that he says in that parable that he teaches, he said, listen, the storms are going to come. How many have had storms in your life? Just a few of us, a couple of us, one or two of us. You know, it's in the emphatic. Jesus said the rain is going to come, the wind is going to blow, the storm is going to arise. But you can be secure if your foundation is right. Then he talks about the man who built his house upon the rock. When those storms came, it weathered it. It survived it. But the man who built his house on the sand, and the sand represents the humanistic concepts of this world, our feelings, our flesh, our thoughts, things that are not of God. When you build your house on that, it said, great was the ruin thereof. Paul, I think, picks up on this, and no doubt Paul was an Old Testament scholar, but he picks up on this concept, I think, in Ephesians chapter 2, and they'll put these verses up on the screen for you. In Ephesians chapter 2, Paul says, starting in verse 19, listen carefully. Now, therefore, you are no more strangers or foreigners, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and with the household of God. Wisdom has built her house. And then he goes on to say, and you are built upon the foundation. Here's the sure foundation that we have. This is the foundation that wisdom brings. The foundation of the apostles, that's the New Testament. The prophets, that's the Old Testament. Jesus Christ himself being the gospels, being the chief cornerstone. He's the one who holds it all together. In fact, Jesus is going to come to the fore in our study tonight, right out of Proverbs chapter 9. In whom the whole building, now listen, we're considered a building. We have foundations. We're going to see we have walls. We have a roof. We have protection, and we're builded for a purpose. In whom the whole building is fitly framed together unto a holy temple in the Lord. In whom you also are builded together for a habitation of God through his Spirit. So when we come and we study truth, and we hear it, and we apply it. We build our lives upon it. We make sure the teachings of the Bible, Old Testament, New Testament, the Gospels, are the foundation for our life, and we begin to build this protection around us. God's Spirit inhabits that. That's what wisdom does. That's what wisdom is all about. And here, Solomon is saying, now wisdom hath built her house. She hath hewn out her seven pillars. Now, you all know as numerologists, and I know all of you guys are numerologists, right? You know that numbers in the Bible have significance. You know the number 12 is the number of human government. You know the number of three, God does things in three. There's God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It's the number of God. You also know the number of seven is the number of completion. The number eight is the number of new beginnings. In fact, this flows over into our music. Now, I'm not musical, but I know something about music. I know that there are seven notes or keys. And then the eighth one, you go to another octave. Someone told me that. I thought that was good. But it's true. Seven is the number of maturity. It's the number of completion. And he says, wisdom has hewn out her seven pillars. What in the world is he talking about? Well, I find it interesting that in Galatians chapter 2, listen carefully, here's what is being said in Galatians chapter 2. This is Paul speaking. You remember when he went up in Acts chapter 15 and he had to confront James and Peter and those guys concerning God's grace being the way we're saved, not by the works of the law. You don't have to be circumcised and keep the law of Moses to be saved. So when he goes up to speak to the leadership, he goes up to the mother church. He goes up to the head church where James was, guys. He says this, and when James and Peter and John, who seemed to be, what's the next word?
Pillars.
Pillars. perceived the grace that was given to me. When I began to share with them how God had called me, how God was using me, they gave to me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship that we should go unto the heathen, unto the Gentiles, and they to the circumcision or to the Jews. It's interesting when you talk about men that God has stood up in the church, men like Pastor Chuck Smith, men like, you know, Charles Stanley, men like, you know, and I'm glad Charles is still standing, not just sitting. I'm glad he's still able to teach at his late age. And you see men that God has stood up. These are pillars. Mature men, men of the Word, men of the Spirit. Pastors and teachers. And they stand up because they have something to say. And what they have to say is the wisdom that God has hewn out in their lives that they dispense to the lives of others because they are under shepherds. They have been given charge over God's sheep. In fact, we read in Ephesians that God gave some to be apostles and prophets and evangelists and pastor teachers for the perfecting of the what? Saints. For the work of the ministry, till we all come to maturity, to the full stature of the very image of Christ. Those are the pillars he's talking about. And the pillars of the church today are those men who dispense truth accurately, correctly, without any apology whatsoever. Those are the pillars. In fact, the Psalm says, if the pillars of the church be taken away, where will the righteous run? So here, Solomon is saying to his son Rehoboam, listen, wisdom has an action. It has a response in your life. The first thing it does is it builds this house of protection that you can dwell in, that the Holy Spirit inhabits. The foundation of that house is the Word of God. The second thing it does is hew out men of God that God has put in charge as overseers for the church. These mature men, these men of the Word. These men whose job is, as they've been called out and set up into this position, to teach you, to feed you, to bring you to maturity until you come to that place where you exemplify Jesus. So let's read that verse again. Wisdom hath builded her house. She hath hewn out her seven pillars. Now let me say, wisdom, as we walk through the rest of chapter 9, as it was in chapter 8, is personified as a female. She. I think for a couple reasons. I just need to put this in. Won't cost you any extra. It's a footnote. Write it down as a footnote. Number one, if a young man is going to pursue anything in life, it'll probably be a young woman. And so I think it kind of like the obvious is he's telling Rehoboam, you need to seek women like you're seeking the young ladies around here. Because, you know, every young man, he wakes up at one moment in his life and he realizes the girls don't have cooties. He actually begins to notice that they smell different. For me, that was about the sixth grade. Candy Hayes sat next to me in the sixth grade. She sat next to me in the fifth grade. We had the same teacher. In the fifth grade, she had cooties. When I came back to the sixth grade, man, something smelled different. Wow, her skin looks soft. She's sweet. I like the smell of her hair. You know, so, and then all of a sudden, you know, it's like, whoa, you know. Girls, and he says, as you are awakened to that, let wisdom do the same thing. And plus, I think women are smarter than men. That's my application for that. Wisdom, female. Ladies, you can say amen. Yeah. Verse 2, she hath, now watch carefully as we walk through this verse. It's very interesting. You can see it pretty clearly if you're looking for it. She hath killed her beasts. The word for kill there is slaughter, and it's the same word used back in Leviticus as a priest would slit the throat of the sacrificial lamb to offer it up as a sacrifice for sin. Same word. And when God had brought his people out of the nation of Israel, out of bondage by miraculous events through Moses, which was a type of Christ, and he led them out into the wilderness there at Mount Sinai, he gave them instructions on how to worship him, and he gave him this imagery of a lamb slaughtered. It was the sin offering that you had to bring when you had sinned. And when the blood was applied to the altar and it was done in a very ceremonial way, then the transgressor could be declared to have atonement with God. his sins would be covered. And this is the imagery here. Wisdom hath slaughtered. And this is the idea is like a priest would slaughter an animal. It has slaughtered its beast. She has mingled her wine. She has furnished her table. What was the table in the holy place? And what was on that table? Shewbread. Bread and wine. Now, if you think I'm stretching, in a few moments we're going to read a little clearer that he's talking about communion. Wisdom begins with a relationship with Jesus Christ. Old Testament looking forward to the Lamb of God who will take away the sins of the world. New Testament looking back. That's why you've often heard me say that John was the last Old Testament prophet, the cousin of Jesus, but yet he was the first New Testament prophet. John was the first Old Testament prophet to see Jesus, the Messiah, and to be able to proclaim, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." But the moment he confesses that, he becomes a New Testament guy because he's under the blood of Christ now as he receives him as the Messiah, so he's the first New Testament prophet. And here we see she has slain her sacrifice, wisdom has. She has mingled the wine, and Jesus said on that last night when he took the second cup, there were four cups in that meal, the Passover meal, but the second cup was a cup of blessing. He said, "This cup is my blood, the new covenant that I make with you." She has furnished her table. She's putting the 12 loaves of shewbread. In the Hebrew, they would have understood when they talk about furnishing the table, those Old Testament saints would have understood. They're obviously talking about the shewbread and the Holy of Holies. You know, I got to stand. You know, someone asked me the other day, what were some of the events that were very meaningful to you when you went to Israel? And I'm going to tell you, a lot of my pastor friends, I'd never been there. My dad lived there for 4 or 5 years. Kyle and I had never gone. Too busy in missions work. And if we were going to be out of the country, we'd be in, you know, somewhere in South America, or we'd be in Africa or someplace else. But finally, you know, the stars aligned and we got to go. And I didn't have any of those aha moments. You see, I don't worship Israel as a place to be worshipped. I thank God for the things that took place in Israel. But there are things about Israel that move me, and one of the most moving events for me, like when I went to Turkey, there was a place, and I want to share it with you guys one of these times when we look at the pictures, when I went to Antioch, Syria, when I was there in that mountain cave church that Peter and was there when, excuse me, not Peter, Paul was there when the Holy Spirit said, "Separate Paul and Barnabas unto the work I've called them to." There was a moment there where I could sense that work of the Spirit, that this was the place where missions started. What was it like when those men, those elders, were gathered together praying, and the Holy Spirit said, was it audible? Was it in their hearts? Was it unified? Did one speak up and pray? I don't know. But I stood at the place where that happened in April. And a few weeks ago in Shiloh, I stood where the tabernacle rested for 369 years. The last place where Israel had possession of the Ark of the Covenant was in Shiloh, before they thought it was a weapon of war and took it out against the Philistines and it was captured. And I got to stand, I did purposely, they had a fence there where you couldn't go to the Holy of Holies where the Ark of the Covenant sat, but you could see right there where it was. They had the outline there as they excavated it. But I stood where the menorah would have stood, the 3-foot gold menorah representing the Holy Spirit. And then I walked across and stood with the table of shewbread, the Word of God, the living Word come from heaven, which was represented by those 12 loaves that should govern human government, the bread. And then I went and stood where the table of incense, the prayer should have been offered. And I'm going to tell you, goosebumps upon there even right now, just knowing that God's presence abode in that place for 369 years. And men traveled from all over Israel to bring a sacrifice to that place so that their sins could be atoned for. And once a year, high priest walked past where I was standing into the holy place and offered the sacrifice and the blood upon the mercy seat for the cleansing of sin for the nation of Israel. That was moving for me. And here we see that wisdom has slaughtered her sacrifice. She's mingled her wine. She's set her table. Because listen, Jesus is wisdom. And if you want the wisdom of God, he who hath not the Son hath not the Father. He that has the Son has the Father. Jesus said, you must be born again. And when you are, listen, all of this wisdom, the wisdom of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth enters into you. She has sent forth her maids. Not only does wisdom come inside of us and it becomes the foundation for our lives, the protection and the provision for our lives, but the Lord would say to us, when that comes to your life, you have a responsibility to share it with others. Did you know that? In fact, in Matthew chapter 28, they'll put it on the screen, verses 19 and 20. These are the last commandments of Jesus. Jesus is instructing us before he goes away. Now, he tells us in John's Gospel, chapter 14, that he's going away to prepare a place for us. And when the place is done, he's coming back to receive us so that where he is at, we might be also. And we're anxiously waiting for that moment. And I don't know that we got too much longer to wait. We'll take a good look at that overview on Sunday, again, just to remind ourselves of the time we're living in. But this is what Jesus said. He said, go ye therefore and teach all nations. He didn't say get saved and just, man, enjoy your salvation, you four and no more, and just kind of, you know, work your way. No, he said, listen, this is a commandment. It's in the imperative in the Greek. That you and I have a responsibility once we've received this, freely you have received. What's the next part of that verse? Freely you are to give. You may say, well, you know, Pastor, I don't have the gift of witnessing. I don't have the gift of evangelist. Well, there's some people that have that gift, but that doesn't let you and me off the hook. I'm not an evangelist either. But I'll share my faith everywhere I go. Because that's part of the outliving of being born again. He says, go ye and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever have commanded you. And lo, I'm with you even unto the end of the world. Amen. So watch how this, we're seeing the gospel being communicated by Solomon to his son Rehoboam in ways that they may not have seen it, but we see it. She has sent forth her maids. She crieth upon the highest places of the city. Wisdom is calling people to repentance. Listen, there are words that are no longer used in church anymore. Listen, when I got saved, I came out of the hippie movement. I was a drug-abusing, amoral idiot. People ask me, what do you used to be? Because I guess some people used to be Catholics or Jehovah's Witnesses or Mormons. I was a pagan. And I got saved. And when I heard words like repentance and discipleship and discipline and submission to the will of the Father, dying to self, picking up your cross and following me, those things meant things to me. They still mean things to me. Because the Holy Spirit is in this world and it's in you and me, and we're vessels in which God uses to call men to repentance, to turn from your wicked way, to accept Christ as your Savior. Wisdom is crying in the high places of the city. Listen to what it says in verse 4. Whosoever is simple. Now, there are four types of people, we've said this before and I'll say it again, that Proverbs deals with. The simple one is the first. You read it in the earlier chapters. The simple person is the immature person. It's a person who just doesn't know. Maybe they're just not old enough or mature enough, or maybe they are old enough and they just don't know. They're simple. They're simpletons. Then the second person it deals with is the fool. The fool knows, but thinks he's wiser than the Scripture. He thinks he doesn't need to be obedient to the Word of God. He's wiser than the Word of God. He's smarter than the Word of God. He can figure it out on his own. He doesn't need necessarily, and you've heard people say those kind of things. Well, yeah, I know the Bible says that, but. How many have ever heard that? That's a fool or a foolish person. The third is the scorner, and he's going to talk about that in a few moments. The scorner is the one who mocks the Word of God. Now, they know it. But not only do they think they're wiser than it, they actually begin to mock it. In fact, one of the warnings we have in the New Testament, it says in the last days, you know, there's going to come scorners mocking prophecy, saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since our fathers fell asleep, all things remain the same. They mock the Word of God. And then, of course, the last one is the wise man, the wise woman who realizes that this word is inerrant, it's inspired, it's authoritative. They use it as the foundation for their life. They build their life upon it. They're obedient, just like Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, they follow no other. They that love me keep my commandments. They follow Jesus, they're obedient. Those are wise men. So listen to what he says. Whosoever is simple, let him turn in hither. Let him turn into the Lord. Let him turn in to Jesus. Let him be filled with the Holy Spirit and with wisdom. Whosoever is simple, let him turn in hither. As for him that lacketh, that old King James wanteth, but your new King James or some other translation you may have, lacks understanding. If he's lacking understanding and he's immature, turn in here. She saith unto him, wisdom is speaking to him, come eat my bread and drink of the wine. That's Jesus. You remember when Jesus said to a great multitude that were gathered around one day, and I think they were looking for more loaves and fishes, but they said, Jesus said to them, unless you eat my body and drink my blood, you cannot be my disciple. Many turned away and stopped following him. Obviously, it was such a great multitude that Jesus looks now at Peter and the gang and said, are you going to leave too? And he says, where are we going to go? Only you have the words of eternal life. There is no option B. It's all you or nothing. And here, wisdom is crying out to the simple, to the immature, the one who is lacking, and say, turn in here, eat my bread, drink my wine, which I have mingled, forsake the foolishness. Forsake it. Turn from it. The word is it has the same sense as turning from something. In the New Testament, the word for repentance is metanoia, and it means to turn around and go in the opposite direction. Forsake foolishness and live. And go in the way of understanding. That's what you need. That's what I need. That's what happened to me 45 years ago in a little Bible study in the mountains. And the Holy Spirit came in, the Spirit of truth. And it's been teaching me ever since how to walk in truth. Now here's what he says to the scorner. Verse 7, listen carefully. So if we're this person who lacks understanding, lacks wisdom, we hear a calling, and we turn in. And now we become one with Christ. We drink from the same cup. We eat from the same loaf. Communion means we're one with Christ now. We're born again. That's the sense here. One of the first things that happened to me when I was born again is I went out to try to tell all of my friends. How many had that experience? Some would say, well, I don't know, it sounds right, I'm not really sure. I'm glad it's working for you, I don't know if it worked for me. They were simple. And then others were foolish. Would say, that stuff will never work. You'll be right back, it won't be long, and you'll be back doing drugs with us again and all that. And they were foolish. And some mocked and scorned. This is what he's saying. Now listen carefully in verse 7, this is very important. He says this. He that reproveth a scorner. This is not a simple person, and this is not a foolish person. This is one who thinks that they're so much wiser than God and his truth and his word that they actually scorn it. They mock it. They resist it vehemently and almost to the point of blasphemy. They mock God's word. And when you run across a person like this, here is what Solomon is saying to his son Rehoboam. He that reproveth a scorner getteth to himself shame. You're going to get insulted. You're going to get mocked. You're going to get treated poorly. Because that's what scorners do. And in fact, he goes on to say not only that, and he that rebuketh, if you go a step further and rebuke a wicked person, you're going to get to yourself a blot. Old King James, your Bible, New King James may say a bruise. Listen, it's not going to go well. Now, how many think that you have the responsibility to tell people the truth? We all do. How far does that responsibility go? Solomon here is going to give us, as we're going to read a few other verses here, he's going to give us clarity about this. In fact, he will say in Proverbs chapter 23, verse 9, when we get there, and we may not get there this side of heaven, but we're working our way quite quickly in that direction. Here's what Solomon says later in this same book. He says, "Speak not in the ears of a fool, for he will despise the wisdom of thy words." Well, but we're called to speak to those people. Yeah, we are. Titus will tell us, or Paul writing in a pastoral epistle to Titus, and probably Titus had the question, how long do we continue to speak truth into people's lives that don't want to hear it? Here's what Paul writes back to Titus, and he says this, a man that is a heretic, that won't listen to the truth, that is erring from the truth, after the first and second admonition, just reject him. Just let it go. You have told that person the truth. You've done it once, you've done it twice, and if they are mocking it, if they're scorning it, if they choose to reject it, and that's what the definition of a heretic is, then just reject them. Have nothing more to do with them. Knowing, this is what you need to know when they're mocking, that he that is such is subverted and sinneth. There's some sin in his life, because remember, the Bible says they don't come to the light because they love their deeds, and their deeds are done in darkness. There's some bondage to some sin that's holding them there. That's why they don't want to hear the truth. They don't want to come out of darkness into the light because they're in bondage, being condemned of themselves. Just let it go. You've spoken the truth one or two times. Let it go. In fact, this is what Jesus says. This tops all the other authority in chapter 7, verse 6. Listen to what he says. Give not that which is holy unto dogs, neither cast your pearls before swine. I wish Jesus would just be more clear. You know, because he says the scorners are dogs. Dogs in the Hebrew culture were considered one of the most filthy animals. They weren't domesticated. They not like my dog. Well, I think he's domesticated, but you know, he got a bath today. You know, he's part of the family. I mean, but those dogs ran wild in those days, and they were filthy animals. And swine was unclean, lest they trample them under their feet and turn again and rend you, attack you. So Jesus is saying, listen, that which is special, listen, for me, this is special. You know, one of the things that you'll observe when you go to Israel, and I've seen it a couple times, I've seen it at the airport coming back from Africa when you run into an Orthodox Jew. I'm talking about the guy with the hat that doesn't fit his head and the curlicues that come down. Have you seen those guys? There's a bunch of them. When we were at the airport in Tel Aviv, there was a bunch of them there. In fact, one guy opened up his suitcase, and I had a conversation with him. I was going to try to witness to him, and he opened up his suitcase, and he had all of this vacuum-packed food. It was kosher food. I said, what is that for? He goes, well, we're going to New York, and I'm taking my kosher food with me. And his buddy said, well, give him a snack. And I said, well, I'll eat kosher food. And so I got to talking to him a little bit, because I've had conversations with him before, but then the line began to move, and it didn't go any past that. But when you run into those kind of guys, what was my point? Let me go back and read, because I got into the story so well. What was my point? Okay, here's my point. They will mock what you believe about the word. And so here's Jesus saying, listen. I got it now. It came back. See how the brain works sometimes? It just, man, sometimes it'll take a vacation and it'll come right back. you watch those guys. I'm glad they're short vacations. Just, you know, moments of senility. But you watch them open. I was in the airport coming back from Uganda one time, and I think Mikey was with me, and I pointed out one of those guys getting ready to pray. It was noon, and he got out, and he wrapped his arm with the phylactery, put it around his head, and he began to do the thing, and he, you know, headed toward Jerusalem East, and then he opened up this book, no doubt the Old Testament, and he did a very interesting thing. You know what he did? He kissed it. The Word. I thought, how many times have I opened the Word and never expressed my appreciation and my love for it like that? And why would I give this to somebody? Because that's how I feel about it. I long since ago, 40 some odd years ago, made a decision. Those who love your Word, Lord, will be my friends. Those who do not love your Word will not be my friends. Because you tell us in Psalms that you honor your Word above your name. And this Word is precious to me. It is the bread of life for me. And I want to be obedient to every jot and tittle of it. And when you offer what is precious to you and somebody scorns it and mocks it, according to my understanding of the scriptures, Paul writes to Titus, I only have to do it a couple times. And then I can reject that person. And Jesus says, don't take what is precious to you like the pearl of God's Word and offer it to dogs or pigs, lest they trample what is precious to you under their feet and then turn around and attack you for it. We're living in a time when that's going to happen, because Jesus said in the last days, you're going to be hated of all nations for his name's sake, because you believe that he is who he said he was and you stand on his truth. You builded your house on wisdom. And he's telling us here, if you reprove a scorner, you're going to get to yourself shame. If you rebuke a wicked man, you're going to get a blot. Reprove not a scorner, he tells us. Just let it go. In fact, there's a verse that one of my professors in Bible college used to quote all the time. You know, he would say, the Bible says, let the unjust be unjust still. And he said, I look at you students and let the stupid be stupid still. You know, because he would always talk about us, you know, we turn in bad reports or whatever. You know, let the unjust be unjust still, let the stupid. And, you know, he wasn't a real kind professor, but, you know, he was right. But but rebuke not a scorner, lest he hate thee. But listen to what he says. Rebuke a wise man, and he will love thee. I will tell you of a truth, the men in my life that have formed my character, that have discipled me, the men that I allow to speak into my life, and I can count on my hand and have fingers left over who those men were. There were three of them, as a matter of fact. It's Pastor David Hood, who pastored the church that the Bible College was associated with. It was associated with that church. Chuck Smith and his nephew, my pastor, Bob Fromm. And it didn't matter what those men said. And some of them said some very hard things and some very, you know, hurting things to me, but they were right. I've told you the story before with Pastor David Hood, that when we were in Bible college, the church would allow us to do the chapel service on Sunday nights. And so it was my night to speak, and we were in the prayer room, and we were praying, and you know, the church was probably over 1,000 people, so there's going to be several hundred people out there for chapel service. The people from the church would come and listen to us Bible college students teach. It was my night to teach. I'd gotten prepared. I had my Angel Flight suit on. I had my 3-inch lift shoes. And man, I had been standing in front of a mirror practicing for weeks. I had my message down pat. And so we're in the prayer room, and a friend of his, a pastor friend, had come from another town to visit Pastor Hood, and they were talking. And so Pastor Hood, after the time of prayer before we went out to start the service, turned and looked at me, and he says, you know, Mike, I believe that this guy has a message for our church, and so we're going to have him speak tonight. We'll have chapel service next Sunday. You can speak next Sunday night. You can imagine. He must have seen it on my face, because I was hurt and I was angry, and my thought was, how dare you? This is my night. I practiced for this night for weeks. I prepared the message. I have the angel flight suit on, dude. I'm looking. This is my night. And as we walked out of their prayer room, I think he could sense my spirit and the pride that was bubbling up out of me. And he grabbed me by the arm. Now, you got to know that I was off and on dating his daughter. And I am so glad that never, no, but no offense, Patty, if you're listening, but he grabbed me by the arm, he spun me around, he looked me square in the eye, and he said, young man, pointed his finger, young man, there is no place in the kingdom of heaven for hurt feelings. You need to get over yourself. You ain't all that important. It was right. A wise man listens. And guess what happens when he sets aside his pride and he listens to what those pillars in the church are saying to him? And I'll tell you, in my opinion, David Hood, Pastor David Hood, was a pillar in the church. Man of God, a man of the word. You rebuke a wise man, he will love you. I love that man. Give instruction to a wise man, and he will yet be wiser. Teach a just man, and he will increase in learning. And then he tells us the key to this thing as he winds it down. He says, the fear of the Lord. We know what that is from back in chapter 8. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride, arrogancy, the evil way, and the forward or perverted mouth do I hate. The fear of the Lord, which is to hate evil, is the beginning of wisdom. Now, Solomon's going to end where he began, because this was the first statement he made back in chapter 1 as he's instructing his son Rehoboam. He begins with this statement, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. As he's ending this section, he ends with the same thing. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And the knowledge of the holy, which is the scriptures, is understanding. For by me, now this is wisdom speaking again, the truth of God's word, by me thy days shall be multiplied, and the years of thy life shall be increased. There is a benefit to being obedient to God's word. In fact, when we go back to Deuteronomy chapter 28, he says, if you will keep my commandments, if you will obey my ordinances, if you will walk in my precepts, then I will bless you and the blessing will overtake you. And then when you go through that section, everything in your life is going to be blessed. In fact, at the very end of that section, he says, and everything that you touch will be blessed. But if you don't, then he moves into the curse. He says, in fact, ends up everything you do will be cursed. And when you walk through that section of Deuteronomy, he's talking about your work, your family, your marriage, your kids. I mean, all of these will be blessed if you're obedient. If you're not, all of those will be cursed. And it's interesting, as the nation of Israel was coming into the land of Israel, and we stood on Mount Gerizim, and we looked across to Mount Ebal, and we saw the place, Shechem below, where the nation of Israel would have passed through, and on one mountain, the mountain we stood, was the blessing. On the other mountain came the cursing. It was pronounced upon them as they entered the land, so they wouldn't forget it. It was another place I marveled, because I thought the mountains were further apart. You could actually, if you were on the other side, you could have screamed and someone could hear you. And then we could look down, and they had excavated the post. You could see it down there where they put the law of the Lord on the post, and they had to pass by it as the cursings and the blessings were being pronounced on the nation of Israel as they entered the promised land. That was an aha moment for me too. There's several of them. But he says this, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. For there are benefits in keeping these things, multiplied of days and years. Then he says this in verse 12, if thou be wise, and the if is in the conditional case, if you apply wisdom, if you seek her and find her, if you build your life upon her, listen to what he's saying, if thou be wise, thou shalt be wise for thyself. The benefit will be for you. But in contrast, if thou be a scorner, thou shalt alone bear it. We come to the New Testament and we have a verse that describes this, and I think in a clearer way. We come to Galatians chapter 6, and no doubt Paul, being an Old Testament scholar, probably understood that verse, and then, you know, he says this, be not deceived. You know, those three words are incredible to me because for several reasons. Number one, it tells me that I have the capacity and the propensity to be deceived. Do you understand, even as a follower of Jesus, because here Paul is writing, and I got to visit the areas of Galatia and Cappadocia when we went to Turkey. We left Tarsus, where we got to visit where Paul's home was, the well out in front, the Roman road, and we followed up through the Tarsus Mountains over to Antioch Pisidia, and we came through Cappadocia and Galatia, and we visited the sites where the Byzantine churches had built their churches in the 3rd century over the top of the 1st century churches and some of the synagogues. And so we got to visit that area, beautiful area. And Paul is writing to the Galatians, and he's saying, be not deceived. In fact, the thing I want to say about those, they were fleeing under persecution because they wouldn't denounce their faith. And they lived in these places, and you saw some pictures of them, we sent them back home, where they actually had carved into mountains. They were living in caves. They were hiding. And he writes to these people who love the Lord, be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Here he says, if a wise man applies wisdom to his life, here's what he just said, he does it for his own benefit because he will be blessed of the Lord. But if a scorner scorns the wisdom of God and does not apply it to his life, he will suffer the consequences alone for that scorning. Here, Paul would say, listen, don't be deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever you sow, you're going to reap. For he that soweth to the flesh, the scorner, obviously sowing to the flesh, shall reap of the flesh corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall reap of the Spirit life everlasting. And listen, we're all sowing seeds. Make no mistake, every decision you make, everything you do, every thought you have, everything you're doing as you're making your way through this life, you are making decisions either to walk in righteousness or unrighteousness, either to walk into the light or walk in darkness, either allow yourself to be deceived by your own wisdom or surrender your life to the wisdom of God and build your life upon this foundation of truth. And whatever we sow, we're going to reap. This is what Solomon is saying to his son Rehoboam. The decisions you make are that important. They're not without consequence. And so he goes on to say, as he closes out this chapter talking about consequences, he says this in verse 13, a foolish woman. Now, again, he's going to use temptation, stupidity, foolishness, scorning in the female, you know, vernacular as well, because wisdom is a she. The temptations, the foolishness, the scorning, it's also a she. A foolish woman is clamorous. She is simple and knows nothing. So if you lean that way to your own wisdom, you know nothing. Going back to Proverbs chapter 3. Commit your ways to the Lord. And He will direct your paths and give you understanding. Because if you don't, you know nothing. You stumble in darkness, the New Testament says, and you don't even know what you stumble over. A foolish woman is clamorous. She is simple. Clamorous means she's loud. She's simple. She knows nothing. For she setteth at the door of her house. Notice she's not building anything. Wisdom builds something. It builds a foundation. It builds a life. It builds protection and provision. This foolishness builds nothing. It sets at the doorstep of the house. And it sets in the high places of the city so that it can be seen. To call passengers who go right on their way. They have no intention to listening. They're going in a certain way. And now this temptation comes. And it calls them to make a detour. Whosoever is simple, lacks understanding, let him turn in hither. And as for him that wanteth, that lacks understanding, she saith to him, if you lack understanding, stolen water, man, it's sweet. Nobody will see, nobody will know. Take a drink. And bread eaten in secret, it's pleasant. But he knoweth not that the dead are there, and that her guests are in the depths of hell. So as a father would, and as a father should, as we as fathers do, and as our Heavenly Father has done for us, we want to impart wisdom to our children. Because we know wisdom, the truth of God's word, is a sure foundation. It's the foundation, if you build your life upon it, when the storms come, you're not going to be shaken. It's a foundation that builds high walls of protection and provision. And by the way, wisdom personified is Jesus. If you eat that bread and drink that wine, if you have communion with Him and you're born again, you'll be wise. And you'll be so wise, you'll tell others about this wisdom, hoping that they will come. And you'll warn others not to listen to the temptations of the world, but to fear the Lord, because the fear of the Lord is to hate evil, to hate pride. See, pride is what got us in this mess. The temptation of Eve was pride. If you eat of this fruit, you'll be as wise as God. Pride, arrogancy. Arrogancy is pride manifest in our lives where we say we know better than God. And the perverted mouth, do I hate, saith the Lord. And when those things cry out to you, don't turn in that way. Because there are blessings to being obedient, and there are curses to being disobedient. And listen, don't be deceived. God is not mocked. There will be no successful sinners. If you sow to unrighteousness, you're going to reap it. If you sow to blessing, you're going to reap that too. To obedience, you'll reap blessing. Amen. I love how clear God's word is. It's not many options. It's one or the other. Jesus would say, you're either for me or you're against me. There's no middle ground. There's no gray area. You're either obedient or you're disobedient. You're either saved or you're not saved. You're either righteous or you're unrighteous. You're either going to heaven or you're going to hell. You see how clear Jesus makes it? There's not a lot of options. No wonder Peter and the gang said, we're not going anywhere. The things you have to say to us are tough, man. They are tough. We eat your body and drink your blood. What he's saying is, become one with me. That's a tough saying, But hey, listen, the others, when they hear the tough sayings, may leave, but we're not going anywhere. And the reason we're not going anywhere, only you have the words of eternal life. And I think maybe Peter and the gang broke out on that song. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. Though none go with me, and a lot just left, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me. They can edit this from the tape. So I will follow, because nobody wants to hear me singing. Listen, we're going to follow Jesus. We're going to build our lives upon this, because there is a storm coming. We're going to talk about that Sunday morning. And when the dust clears and the, well, when the dust settles and the smoke clears, you're going to be Lambos. Most incredible movie series I ever saw is you've got Rambo taking on the whole Russian army with a bow and arrow. I mean, they got helicopters and machine guns. He's got a knife and a bow and arrow. And I saw that movie, and man, at the end, he wins. And this was years ago that the movie came out, and I was pastoring a different church, and the next Sunday I said, "This, I just saw an incredible movie." And I'm going to tell you right now, you guys need to be Lambos. The next Sunday, there's a bunch, because the place was packed. It was kind of hard to get into. And there's like five or six ladies in the front row that had brought these kind of like camo T-shirts, and they had the bandanas around their head. And on it, it said Lambo. And so they went and had it printed up. Man, we ought to have some of those. We're Lambos, man. We're in it to the end. We're in it to win it, amen? We're running like we're going to achieve something. And we're not deceived. The decisions that we make, the way we behave, listen, is going to produce for us eternal benefits. And we're not listening to the silly woman sitting on the steps crying to us, come in here. Sweet water, stolen water is sweet. No, things eaten in secret. Man, no, no, they're not, because the secret things will one day be exposed. And I want to hear from Jesus, well done. Thou good, not perfect, but good. And faithful servant. Amen? Let's stand. Hey, I'm 3 minutes early. Read ahead. We'll be in Proverbs chapter 10 next week. It's a different section, and I can't guarantee we're going to get through a chapter a night, because it's a bunch of pithy, powerful statements just kind of put together. And sometimes one or two or three will be enough for an evening. Sometimes one will be enough. Sometimes we can get through a whole chapter. We'll have to see. But I will guarantee you we're going to spend a lot of time, guys, when we get to chapter 31. We'll spend a few weeks on that one. Chapter 31. Anybody getting that at all? Chapter 31, yeah. We'll spend a lot of time on chapter 31 when we get there. Father, we thank you for your word. And Lord, we thank you that it is a scalpel. Paul calls it, writing to the Hebrews, sharper than any two-edged sword, because it does surgery. It removes cancer, it removes tumors, it heals. And Lord, we thank you that many times your word may hurt us. There have been many times when I've sat alone with your word and, man, it's cut. It cuts. Many times I've had men speak in my life, and it hurts. It hurts. As they've spoken truth into my life, it hurts. But it has never harmed me. And at that moment when it hurts, I have to make a decision. Have I heard truth, and do I fear God? And I'm unwilling to lay aside my pride and hear what you have to say, Lord, and forsake foolishness that I might live. Man, Lord, I pray that that would always be the right decision for me, to know that you may be hurting me, but you're never going to harm me. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship the Lord. Good to us, Lord, better than we deserve, for sure. And Lord, we just thank you tonight again for your word. We thank you again tonight, Father, for how it is living and powerful, and it, Lord, that it's still speaking into the hearts of men and women. It's still crying from the high places, saying, if you lack wisdom, turn in here, eat from my bread, drink from my cup. And Lord, we thank you that that's still going on. And help us to be a part of that and trying to bring men and women into a place where they know you, Father. Time is short. We're living in the last of the last days. And we could be out of here real soon. And so, Lord, I would just pray that we would be about our Father's business. And pray these things in Jesus' name. And all God's kids would say, amen. Hey, could you do me a favor and pray for me for Sunday? I just really feel like we need to do a prophecy, not so much an update, but a review of the update we already did. But you got to realize that update was 6.5 hours of teaching. And I'm going to try to do it in 60 minutes. So you need to be praying for me on Sunday. Amen. And so if Pastor Todd gets up here and leads one song, opens in prayer, and just say, let's all stand, and I come up, that's because he knows I can't do it in 60 minutes. But I think that, listen carefully, the time we are living in is so close. Now, what we've seen happen before is it's three steps, you know, one step forward, three steps back. But it's moving in that direction. And our nation, along with the support of Israel and some other coalition forces, just took out the most wicked man on the planet. And a million people showed up to mourn his funeral, and there's going to be retaliation. This could set off Psalms 83. This is the sobering time that we are living in. And I can prove to you it's not a wishful thinking that we're living in the last days from the Word. Because all the prophecies that need to be fulfilled have been. Jesus said, when you see these things, look up. Because your redemption draws nearer. And these are not times to be foolish, these are times to be wise. Would you agree? And these are times that pastors, pillars in the church, should be warning people. Man, if you're involved in things you shouldn't be involved in, you need to forsake those things and repent. Would you agree? So pray. Our church is 10 times the size outside of this by live stream. We have 16 satellite churches. We're in 25 different countries. In fact, we have 4 Bible studies in Iran. Some of you didn't know that. Every Sunday they pull down our messages. There's 4 home Bible studies in Iran. The Iranian people, by the thousands, are coming to Christ. Did you know that? And being baptized into the faith of Jesus. So as we are sending out these warnings, they're not just for us. There are people that are listening, that are paying attention, and maybe they'll take that message to their friends in Iran. We have 7 Bible studies in China, Indonesia. There are places that they show up on the thing, because when I talk to the guy, I don't even know where these places are that show up. Amen? So pray, would you? And pray that, you know, we could go home soon. I mean, I want to hear Dave Hocking, but hey, if the Lord wants to take us before Dave Hocking gets here, that'd be great too. He wouldn't have to tell us about it. We could see it.
After the barbecue.
After the barbecue, he said. We will have a barbecue in heaven, I can guarantee you. Angel food, cake, and no calories, man. Amen. So, God bless you guys. If you need prayer, come on up. We'll pray with you. If not, man, be safe on the way home. It's supposed to snow at a little higher elevations late this evening, early morning.